Hi everyone, thank you for coming. I'd like to please ask that you silence your cell phones. Unfortunately, our announcement system is broken, so I'm your announcer for today. But just to make sure that you silence your cell phones and please enjoy the recital. When he moved to Hamburg,
I think he joined the Hamburg Symphony Orchestra playing the horns. And also his mother was Johanna Nissen, I'm sorry. She was actually from wealthy family, part of the bourgeois life. And as you can tell, can you tell the age difference? It was a big scandal when they were married because they just got married after like within a month. So both parents were really into providing good education for their children. So luckily, Johannes Brahms went to private and secondary school. They got the proper education. And since his father was a musician, they had a grand piano at home. And when he decided to play the cello, the parents actually bought the cello for him to play on. Next slide, please. Thank you. So that's a young Brahms, when he was young and very slender. I found he was pretty shy, and his voice was pretty high, like a female. And he also had very long hair and a very blue eye. So that kind of gave everybody an impression, very also female, also a male, characteristics. So in his compositions, you can hear both very feminine and masculine side of the music. Okay, so when he was age 7, he got to learn like proper piano lessons with the Axel Kostel. And when he was like a little bit less than 10, he was accepted to the school under very piano and composition teacher in Hamburg. So, and he was very into Johann Sebastian Bach and the counterpoints. So that's when Brahms learned lots of earlier time classical music and the theory part, and a lot of like remaining his composition incorporates all those complication fugues or harmony changes, so that was all influenced. There was when age like little after 10, he had to quit the school in order to support his family financially, so he had to just go out and play with his dad at the pubs or other like events, private venues. And that's when he encountered with Ede Remenye. He's a Hungarian violinist who was part of the refugee crew moving from Hungary to the United States. As they were going to the United States, they had to go through the Hamburg, and he found this like pub or place to play the violin, and he met Brahms. So he made Brahms to just accompany him or play together, and that's when he was influenced by a lot of folk tunes, folk rhythm. So in his music, you can hear different like, cultural sounds or different rhythm changes. So I wanted to go. And then in 1853, when he was 20, and this big life change happened. So with the same violinist, Brahms was on a tour, and he got to meet Joseph Joachim, who was a very famous violinist at the time, principal of the big orchestra, like concert touring, and also he got to encounter with the Franz Liszt. But sadly, I found a document that Brahms was a little bit sad because a very hard composition he composed, Liszt could just cited it, so he thought he didn't have any talents, but you know, so he just kept going. And the right side is the Joseph Joachim, and the left side is the young Brahms in 20s. They were like, they became very good, close friends playing together. And with the friend Joachim recommended Brahms to meet Schumann, and he actually introduced Brahms to Schumann, both Clara Schumann and Robert Schumann. When Brahms went in and just played his first piano sonata he composed when he was young, they were just amazed, and they just immediately accepted Brahms into the composition life and his musical career, so he can continue. And within like after a month, Robert Schumann asked Franz to join the competition that will be returned for Joachim. So Franz contributed his music to F.A. Sonata, Final Sonata, and what you just heard was the part of the sonata that was written by Franz. Next one, please. And then a big tragic happens at 1856 that also shook Franz's life, that he's like great teacher, he admired, he really, you know, felt connected. His teacher passed away. But as taking care of Clara Schumann and the family, Franz also had to work because he had to make a living for himself. So he was still touring as a concert pianist. And year after, he became the director of the amateur male choir school in Detmold in Germany. And when he was 26, he also founded this like an amateur women's choir. So this is when he got to learn more choral music and just started to write some more music, arranging the music. So that also kind of gave a little different part of his life. He's still going through the journey. For a while, he couldn't compose at all because of a great sadness of losing and so many, like, many things in his life. And it was his friend, Joseph Joachim, who keep sending him a letter, encouraged to continue writing a polyphonic choral, you know, exercises, theoretic harmony progressions. And during that time, Brahms just continued without any questioning. And that's when he actually became very strong of learning the theory side. And those are the significant changes that Brahms' music started to change. Next, please. And then after a while, he was still touring. He was able to compose after Joachim's like encouragement. From 1860s, that he wrote a lot of chamber music. There were two string sextets, one piano quintet, two piano quartet, and a horn trio, and then the cello sonata No. 1, which is what you're going to hear about. And he's still, if you could hear it, as if you can think of him, like his life just shaking, going through all these different places, different cultural changes, and also help with his friend Joachim, like practicing the polyphonic, you know, harmonic progressions, and also still very melodic in melodies. And also from very earlier side, the earlier classical music, musical Bach, you can also kind of hear it in the last movement of the sonata. So I hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
about more of the second half of his midlife, and then going into his like last phase of his life. So thank you. So we were in activities, right? And then with lots of work of chamber music, including Cello Sonata No. 1, he was just coming back to his composition inspiration, motivation, more interaction with friends, you know. So it's continuing his soloist, solo piano life or directing life, school, teaching, conducting. And he got to invited as a conductor, actually. So his conducting career also started from 1860s. There's a big, also another life-shaking thing happened in 1865, that his dear mother, who was very supportive, had passed away, and she he was in such a sorrow, and he didn't know like what to do. And then immediately he turned his core to his Lutheran like faithful life. So he looked over all the biblical texts and chose all this text, like directly chose the text from the Bible and start composing the Requiem. And that became the very famous, like we're well known, the starting of the German Requiem. And within a year, he finished the whole Requiem with the sixth movement. But later in 1869, he had another inspiration of a solo voice, solo soprano singing the last movement. Again, the text was from directly quote from the Bible. When you get a chance, I highly recommend to just listen to it. It's so beautiful, very sorrowful, and very like so like spiritually touching. I didn't write it here, but year after, his dear father, Christian father, also passed away. So this like mid-1860s, he was experiencing a lot of saying goodbye, farewell to his dear loved ones. But on the other hand, he was still touring the concert tours as a solo artist and a director. So he was still, you know, extending his like number of friends or connection or network, we say nowadays. So he was like touring Germany, Switzerland, Austria, Hungary, Denmark, and Netherlands. After this German Requiem, especially from 1869, when the seventh movement was added and performed, that was when his like name and his style, now we know, had been acclaimed as Brahms style, and very well, like that piece was played throughout whole Europe and very well recognized. So including Germany, Switzerland, Netherlands, England, and also Russia, you know, people started to play the German Requiem, and you know, he just continued his like musical composer journey. We're gonna move on to 1870. That's when he started to work on his large ensemble or orchestral music. When he was young, he heard Joseph Joachim playing Beethoven violin concerto in D major. And he was very like inspired. And also he heard the Hamburg Orchestra playing the Beethoven Symphony No. 5, very famous, big, grand orchestra. And also Mozart's Don Giovanni. So he was very like inspired, motivated to compose, but he was not successful until this moment, after all this like life experiences happening, so many things that had just came through his journey. So he started to compose, and then he was actually within a tight time period, he was able to write so many symphonies, now we know. So he wrote all this repertoire, Symphony No. 1, 2, and Violin Concerto, Piano Concerto, and Symphony No. 3 and 4 in very like short time, and also Double Concerto for Violin and Cello, which I'm going to perform again in April. So I would like to invite you for the April concert. And then after the symphonic phase go through, during the 1880s, he started to focus more on the chamber work. And so he composed Violin Sonata number 1, Piano Trio number 2, String Quartet number 1, all together. And Violin Sonata number 2, Piano Trio number 3, and Cello Sonata number 1, which you're about to hear, was composed in the same year, 1886. And then the following year, Violin Sonata number 3 and String Quartet number 2 was composed. For the second sonata, it is a little bit unusual. Normally, the instrument sonata is in 3 movements, like fast, slow, fast. But because of all this experience of composing large ensemble compositions and symphony works, this sonata is in 4 movements. So, and within these 4, I would say a lot of many of the life stories all embedded in each movement, in each section, and also his study or life experience, playing with the folk tunes, with the different country people or different rhythm, dance rhythm, all is in here along with the symphonic style. So maybe I'm just playing with the pianist, it's only 2 instruments, but if you can try to imagine what kind of instrument would play this melody if it was composed in the orchestra. So that will be kind of give you some fun moment to listen. I hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
for encouraging Tomon, like, to actually see my friend and family and my pastor and my family who's watching online in Virginia. And also, I have a family watching overseas in Korea. You know, I really, really appreciate how God led me to stand up here. And as you still continuing my cello journey. And I really wanted to say thank you to my teacher, Professor Lin Shu, just like trusting me, inviting me to come here. Although I couldn't, you know, play a lot, he was always like supporting and listening, and, you know, trying to help. And also a lot of many studio friends still supporting. And also so many of my friends, prayer warriors, like, you know, without your help, I couldn't do it. And also my spiritual mentor, Professor Pastor Jay and Pastor Juan, really appreciate for praying for me. And all together, I wouldn't be able to do this without God's blessing. That, you know, at one point of my journey, I was going to stop the music career, but God really gave me the heart of compassion and sharing my talent to the loved ones or even the future musician like Henry or other young cello students that I'm meeting here. That, you know, so like I always wanted to learn the cello so I can share more greater love, continue to the next generation. As a return of my appreciation and, you know, supporting me, prepared a short song. It is about, it's a poem, the text is a poem by Korean poet Harim, and also music by the composer or arranger Yoon Hak Jun, who also arranged a lot of Christian music and sharing it with a lot of many, you know, people. So I would like to play a little song for you. Thank you.